The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. When the pyramids were 1,000 years old, or somewhere about 2000 B.C., a tribe of wanderers, dissatisfied for their own reasons at the restriction and poverty of their lives, chose to migrate northward in search of a new and better life. The parallel between their migration and our own American drive westward is evidenced in the beginning and the ending of this classic story.
Damn you, Abe, I just don't believe it.
It was Sarah's own free choice, not my doing.
It had to be your doing. And when I tell you the real truth, you won't want any soiled goods. She was my woman before she ever turned her eyes on you.
That's a lie. You take that back or it don't make no mind who you are. You better reach for your gun.
I don't take nothing back but what should belong to me. So reach.
Mystery drama, The Mark of Cain, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Ralph Bell. It is sponsored in part by Contact, the 12-hour cold capsule, and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. For some 50 years among the Plains states, in the middle of the 19th century, cattle was king. Then, bleating and baaing their way from the middle states, came the sheep. What a horse has grazed, a steer can still feed on. What a sheep has nibbled to the bare earth, no animal can survive off. So, a war was declared by the cattle barons. But they were too wealthy and entrenched to do their own fighting. It was easier to hire guns for that. And the most dreaded gun in the West was a man named Cain Tuck.
I'm out here on the street because you called me out, mister. What I want at the gaming table's fair and square. And I'll tell you the same thing about aiming to draw down on me, mister. You don't stand a prayer. Don't move yet. I'm just lifting my hat. You see that mark? The white feather of hair over my left brow? That marks me as the Cain Tuck. That marks my reputation. So I've given you fair warning. You draw down on me, may God have mercy on your soul. Give him fair warning. But why didn't his bullet find me? Pardon me, folks. Nothing more to see. Maybe someone better see to the dead man.
Wasn't he magnificent, Papa?
Yeah, you're a bloodthirsty little filly, I'll say that.
Like father, like daughter.
I'm not so sure I'd want you to be all the way like me, Sharon.
Oh, how can you help it? I've got your blood in my veins. You know, you think that man who calls himself Cain Tuck is something very special.
I see him as a killer, pure and simple.
Tell the truth now, Papa. He just might be the reason we took this side trip away from the railroad in Topeka. So you could talk to him.
If I did, young lady, it's business, and you're no part of it. You should never have seen what you just did.
But having seen it, I will never forget it.
You'd better. Sometimes when I see what the lack of a mother to bring you up... Well, it's quite enough. We're going back to the hotel, and tomorrow morning we shall be heading for home.
But what about tonight?
Tonight, as soon as I settle you, I have business. You'll excuse me, sir. I'd like to buy you a drink.
Why?
Oh, I have some business I'd like to discuss with you.
I drink alone. Maybe you notice there's nobody else around me.
Well, I'd still like to buy you that drink. Perhaps we can talk business in my room at the hotel. My card, sir.
Colonel Jared Creighton, Venture Ranch, Colorado Springs, eh? What are you doing in this little tank town, Colonel?
Well, sir, I was on trip by railroad back from the east, bringing my daughter home from school. I believe you're just the man I've been looking for.
You heard of me?
There ain't many of us in the West that don't know your name, Mr. Kentuck, and your reputation.
And yet you'd still seek me out?
Well, I'm here.
Well, maybe I will have that drink with you, Colonel.
I want to offer you a job, Mr. Tuck.
Cain Tuck, one name. Stands for Kentucky, where I come from.
Oh, no second name.
I shucked that a long time ago, along with the power of other things. I do some wide and fancy roaming. One name's good enough.
Maybe it's time you thought of putting down some roots.
Who would want me?
I wouldn't.
What for?
Well, I mentioned my name was Creighton of the Venture Ranch, the V-Bar C, that's our brand. Perhaps you've heard of it.
I might.
It's a mighty big spread. The high end of it is in the Colorado Territory. Been in my family for four generations since we cleared out the Indians. But now we got two other hostile groups aiming to move in our grazing lands. Settlers and sheepmen.
Well, you ain't alone. All the way down from the Dakotas to Texas.
The settlers we can handle, but some of the sheepmen are raising a bigger ruckus than their stock. And they're mighty hard to discourage.
Yeah, I don't like any man has anything to do with sheep.
Well, I figured you'd see things like a right-thinking man. That's why I wanted to offer you a job.
You want to buy my gun?
Oh, I can hire me 100 guns, same on the other side. And the war goes on, they just cancel each other out. What I want to buy me is full-time protection.
You think I can offer that?
I think the name Cain Tuck can. I reckon they'll know enough not to tangle with you, and they'll stay off my property.
There's a little more to my reputation perhaps you forgot, Colonel Creighton.
Oh, what's that, sir?
I'm a loner. I don't stop long no place because, well, let's say I got itchy feet.
I'm gambling maybe that's because you never had an offer to stay on anywhere before in your, well, in your business. That's why I'm making you an offer strong enough to maybe tie you down.
You don't know the odds you're facing.
I'm willing to take my chances, by God.
Cursed from the earth, which hath opened her mouth to receive thy brother's blood from thine own hand, a fugitive and a vagabond shalt thou be in the earth.
Kentuck? Kentuck, what is it? You all right?
I've suffered enough.
I don't understand why.
There's nothing to understand, Colonel.
Looks as though he's not going to make it, Daddy.
My tarnation train is pretty near departure time. I didn't figure him to let me down.
Well, I don't see why he just didn't ride up here to Pika with us on the stagecoach.
Why, honey, he had some other business to close up.
Well, seems like old Iron Horse fixing to leave. Couldn't you get them to hold up just a piece for him?
Now, you know, it appears to me you've got quite a bit of interest in that King Tuck.
Well, he's almighty handsome.
And kind of old for a little eastern tenderfoot just finished his schooling.
He's not that old. I bet he isn't even 35 yet.
Oh, closer to 40, I'd reckon. Either way's far too old for you and outside your reach. Anyways, you got a man waiting for you back home.
Nina Patterson? I haven't laid eyes on him for near 5 years. He didn't even have a beard when I left. He's just a little old boy, same age as me.
Same as you is right, Sharon. Just so long as he's on our side, trying to get his father straightened out. Why, if anyone had ever told me that Elisha Patterson would turn
Daddy,
into...
he isn't coming.
Maybe just as well things I had on my mind.
Yes, he is. Here he comes.
Howdy, Colonel Creighton.
Well, the train's just about to leave. I thought maybe you'd ducked out on our handshake.
I don't never back out on my word once given. Getting just the right price for my horse held me up.
Well, we'd better get on board.
Daddy.
Oh, my apologies. I reckon you haven't met my daughter.
pleasure, Miss Creighton.
I'm honored, Mr. Tuck.
Just plain Cain Tuck, ma'am. I got no family name. Ain't got no family or home.
Well, looks like maybe you'll have some of both from now on.
Joined up.
You got me on a railroad. First time I ever traveled any other way, save on my own legs or horses.
I never wanted it to come to this. But a man has a right and a duty to protect his property.
And you're buying me to cut down any man who don't.
No, sir. I'm buying you a hope to face down and discourage man who might. For 20 years and more, we've had a cattleman's association, a club, you call it what you will. We've got to protect the grazing lands, the thread of sheep. And the man I counted on most as my friend, my neighbor, the father, the boy I thought my daughter would marry to make a union between the two ranches, has turned on me, weeding out his herd and turning to that abomination of the sheep. Why, we can no longer talk together, huh? Well, I've come to the conclusion that this man, can only learn by example. That's why I want you as my ranch boss.
As executioner.
What?
If anyone won't toe the line as your representative, I force him to draw down on me. And when he does...
No! No, I don't want the reality, only the threat, the pressure, the leverage. I don't want any killing.
No, no one ever really does. You bought yourself just what you want, Colonel Braden.
I feel mighty sure I did, King Tuck.
Can't help myself. It's the only way I have to go. My cross to bear.
He sits there facing the colonel on the narrow train bench. Two coal black eyes as empty and deep as the bottomless pit. His young old face is placid. But a man looking at him objectively could imagine that beneath the sun-leathered skin, 1,000 million nerves writhe and torture themselves. Who is he, this man who calls himself only Cain Tuck? I shall return shortly with Act Two. House of the V Bar C sprawled on two floors over a great area, massive windows opening to the glory of the faraway Rockies. Between the mountains and the house were miles and miles of prairie, grazing lands. This was Creighton land. That is, if it was not totally owned on paper, at least by grazing rights established for 100 years, till the railroad brought the settlers and the sheep west.
You sent for me, Colonel Creighton?
Why, sure, Kent. Come on, join me. Sit down and have some breakfast.
I already ate with the hands of the bunkhouse.
Well, then, sit and have some coffee. You all shook down and settled?
I reckon.
Anything else you need?
Nope. Except, when do I take over?
Well, no hurry for that, son. I mean... Buck Willis has been my ranch boss a long time. No sense rushing him off to pasture. Besides, I got more important plans for you right now.
All right, shoot.
No. I'm hoping it won't have to come to that. I'm kind of trusting to the sound of your name and your reputation to avoid bloodshed.
Who's pressing you, Colonel?
Kentuck, just look out from this room. That's Creighton land out there, has been for over a century. And that's cattle land. Now, they call us cattle barons, but the real royalty is that steer you can see in clumps wherever you look, long or short on. This is his land. And now there's a power of people trying to encroach on what me and my forebears carved out of the wilderness. And I don't take kindly to poachers. I want to drive them off.
with one gun.
If it's a big enough one and packs enough power, those are coyotes feeding off what men had the courage to conquer. You face them down and they'll run.
And if they don't?
Cut them down.
Where do I start?
Oh, I'll give you all names. There's just one I want you to lay off of.
And that's who?
Lige Patterson.
Why?
For 25 years, we were friends. Close as that word can mean. Why, his son and my daughter promised to each other. We were going to partner the ranches, make us the biggest spread outside of Texas.
And then what happened?
Oh, well, given this much credit, the drought has hit him bad these last years. But I never thought he'd turn to sheep as the answer. I still hope to drive some good bonehead common sense into him. I'll tell you something true, Cain Tuck, and you hold it just between us.
I'll tell you the same. I carry enough secrets myself already. I have no need to take on any more.
One reason I went back east to bring Sharon home was I needed to check with them fancy eastern doctors. Make plumb sure. I ain't got long to live. And I aim to make certain sure my daughter's future is secure. I thought I'd set it up through Elisha to son Enoch. And now I got to hedge that bet. So you take your gun and your reputation into battle, and you save the venture spread. And someday soon, I promise you at least a part of it's going to be yours.
Easy, boy, easy.
Hello, Mr. Kento.
Miss Graydon. Plain Cain Tuck, like I told you.
I like it. And you can call me Sharon.
I wouldn't reckon that's my place, Miss Creighton. Easy, boy. Easy now. Easy.
Why do you keep avoiding me? You've been here a while. I never see you.
I've been busy.
Oh, I know. I'm surprised you have time to shoe a horse.
I always shoe any horse I ride myself.
You like to be a lone wolf, don't you?
I never said I liked it. It's my way of life.
You're a strange man.
Yes. Better that way.
Are you telling me the stories are true?
What stories would those be?
Oh, Lyle Peterson up by Colorado Springs. He got shot in the head and his house burned to the ground.
If you're asking me, did I do it? No.
But everyone says you warned him off. Told him to build a fence to hold his sheep in.
Yes'm.
What do you mean, yes'm? Did you tell him that?
I surely did. I'm your father's ranch boss. It's my job.
It's not your job. Buck Willis has been ranch boss ever since I can remember.
Yes'm.
Will you stop saying that?
What?
Yes'm.
Why?
Because it pretends to be something you're not. You are not inferior to me.
I never did say I was.
Well, you just want to put me off.
Put you off what, ma'am?
Will you stop toying with me? I want to know what's going on.
I don't know what you mean.
Oh, come on, Kentuck. You think you're pretty tough. Well, let me tell you, so am I. I am not the nice, genteel little lady my father sent me east to turn into. I'm Western, born and bred. And for all my daddy's want to put a brand on me, I'm a maverick still all the way. You know why I'm back here?
Sure enough. To marry up with Enoch Patterson, so the VRC and the Circle P ranches can join up and be the biggest spread north of Texas.
That is my daddy's idea. But Enoch and his father are too soft to hold a dynasty here in our country. It takes a man to hang on to what he's got and fight off the coyotes, a man like you.
No.
Now, what do you mean, no?
You said it before. Oh, maybe for just a moment I thought I could rest, but you nailed the truth on the barn for me to read. I ain't no ranch boss. Just what I've always been.
Well, what have you always been?
A killer, ma'am.
No.
It's on the record.
In fair fight. In your own defense.
In my own defense, yes. In spite of me, in my own defense.
Hmm? What are you trying to say?
I don't reckon anything I could say would make sense, Miss Sharon. I wish I was just like any other man. I surely do, but the way things are...
Sharon, I've been looking everywhere for you. What are you doing down at the corral? You going riding?
No, Enoch. I was just talking to Kentuck.
Oh, yeah. Hi. You're the new hand.
Ranch boss.
Ranch boss? Well, I thought...
It don't matter. I got things to do. Excuse me, ma'am.
So that's the big bully boy.
Shh, be careful.
Of him? A big mouth with a gun? Why?
He's no big mouth. You better respect his gun.
I got no respect for any hired gun. You know what they say he did to Lyle Peterson and Scrimley Shaw? Shot him from ambush.
You have proof of that?
No, but he called them out, and knowing his reputation, they wouldn't shoot it out with him, so...
So? What?
So he shot him in the back. What else? Either way, they didn't stand a chance.
I don't believe Kentuck ever shot any man in the back. I'll never believe it.
Why not? It's the way he makes his living.
I don't believe that either.
Everyone knows it.
I don't.
Well, you've been away in the East.
Yes, and a lot of things have happened since I've been away.
What?
Well, things are a lot different between your father and mine.
Well, things are changing on the range. We have to move with the times.
Well, you and yours can make your own moves. Why can't you leave my daddy alone?
We'd like to, if he'd leave us alone.
But how does he interfere with you?
Sharon, I didn't come over here to talk about...
I ask you a question.
Damn it, Sharon. He thinks he owns the whole territory. He's got to wake up to respecting his own boundaries.
But it seems to me you're the one who don't respect him.
Sharon, stay out of men's business. Your father only holds title by law to a tenth of the land he claims. The rest is anyone's territory.
Well, for 100 years, nobody ever claimed it. Why now?
Oh, come on, Sharon. You've been east. It's a growing country. People are pushing out.
Well, they don't have to bring those smelly old sheep.
The land's drying up. Sheep can live where cattle can't. But wait a minute. This has nothing to do with us, has it?
But it's all so different now, Enoch.
Because our fathers are feuding?
Well, that and...
And what? It isn't that Cain Tuck. Sharon, don't be taken in. He's no good.
I can make up my own mind about that.
He's a killer. A gun, that's all. His hand against every man, and every man's hand against his.
You don't know him.
I know his type, Sharon. He's marked for what he is, as surely as he's marked by that white streak in his hair.
Well, he can't help that.
Sometimes I wonder even about that. But for the rest, well, he is what he is.
Well, you talk mighty big behind his back.
You want me to say it to his face?
No.
He can call me out. I'm no stranger to handling a gun.
Now, you just stop it, Enoch Patterson. That's enough. Just go on about your business and leave me to mine.
What about us, Sharon? When are we going to be married? Or are we?
Heaven's sakes, Enoch. Would you give me a chance to settle back in? Anyway, right now, till our fathers work out their differences, it's no time to talk about that.
Oh, by heaven, Jared. I've had enough. You can't dictate to me.
Any more than you can to me, Elisha. You cancel that ship on the sheep or you're going to stir up blood.
The only one who's going to stir up blood is you, Jared, with your hired gun. The rest can be talked out.
There's nothing to talk about. This is cattle country, and I won't have it profaned.
You can't stop progress. We're both businessmen. Our first duty is to survive. I have to bring in the sheep.
You'll regret it.
There are a lot of things in my life I've regretted and will live to regret. I don't see this as one of them, except for the children.
No daughter of mine will marry the son of a sheep man.
Why must the fathers visit their sins on the children? Jared, let's face ourselves and our responsibilities. Neither of us has much time left. Let's... Well, each secure what we have and make the children's future safe.
No, sir, not by marrying my daughter to a man who betrayed his friends.
I won't answer that in kind or in unkindness, as I move to do. Just let me favor one point. If you won't give Sharon willingly to Enoch, who else in this still wilderness community would you offer her to?
To a man who has enough guts to protect her and her inheritance and the force to back it up.
To the man named Cain Tuck? A renegade? A killer? An outcast?
I do not judge him that way.
Then you are blind. Look at him closely. The lean, dark, haunted face. The restlessness in him. Look at that shock of black hair with the white plume streaking up above his left eyebrow.
You think that's accident?
Oh, we all turn gray. We both are.
Not that way. To me, that is a special sign. As vivid as the mark of Cain.
It is said in Genesis chapter 4, verse 15, "And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest any finding him should kill him." Is Cain Tuck a latter-day Cain? Is he the killer that he is represented? Has he no saving grace?
I shall return shortly with Act 3. Behold, thou hast driven me out this day from the face of the earth, and I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond in the earth. Genesis 4:14. And a man named Cain Tuck migrated from his native state to end up in the territory of Colorado, a man who was a wanderer by destiny and a killer by trade, and who, for the first time in his life, was about to be offered the love he had always been denied.
You're so quiet tonight, Lush. What is it?
Got a load on my mind, Sarah.
Well, we could always share it before as husband and wife. Why not now?
It ain't woman's business.
Which means fighting and killing. What else isn't?
My darling, there was enough of that in your life, wasn't there? I thought we'd been able to bury the past, but it seems we haven't.
Why, Elisha?
Well, Jared has signed himself on a new hand, a bully boy. Already, though we can't prove it, this man has been guilty of, or at least responsible for, the deaths of three, maybe four, of those of us who opposed Jared.
Oh, why do you let him get away with it? Why don't you make up a posse? Run this hired killer out of the territory?
Why not? Except that we consider ourselves men of honor and abide by the rules of our society. As I said, in most cases, we can't prove he killed a man, and in the one case we can, it was a fair fight.
Fair fight? Like my Abe was killed all those years ago?
I thought we'd put all that behind us.
Oh, darling, Lush. Yes, of course we have. You know I'm all yours. You're my only true love. And that Enoch thinks of you as his own father, even though...
Hush. That's past history. Trouble buried and forgotten, just as I want you to forget the ones I brought up today.
But I'm afraid for you. If you're not next, you must be on the list. And you're no gun handler.
I'm less afraid for myself than I am for Enoch.
Why him?
Well, I think this gunslinger, though he's old enough to be her father, has caught Sharon's eye. And with Jared turned against me the way he is, he just might favor the Cain Tuck over Enoch.
The who?
Cain Tuck. The name he goes by. The only name he uses. Probably afraid to let a body know his real one. What is it, Sarah? You've gone white. White as a sheet. You all right, honey?
I'm all right. Tell me, would this Cain Tuck be at the Venture Ranch today?
I reckon. Why?
Nothing. I'd just like to see what a real killer looks like. Cain Tuck, hold up!
Check, boy. Check. Anything wrong, Miss Creighton?
No. Where are you headed?
Oh, just riding out a piece.
Mind if I join you?
I kind of hankered to be alone.
Oh, that's not polite. Don't you like me?
That's beside the point.
Then can I ride with you?
If you can keep up, yep.
Hey, now, you catch me. You think you can show me your heels, Cain Tuck? You're dead wrong about that.
Sharon.
Yes?
Are you all right, Sharon?
A Oh, Kentuck, I declare. You called me by my given name.
Oh, never mind that. Are you all right?
I never felt better.
You little fool. You almost lost your head when that horse hit that gopher hole.
I lost my head a long, long while before that.
What are you talking about?
You. First time I ever saw you, I fell in love with you.
No.
Oh, why do you run from me, Kentuck? Why do you run from the world?
A man does what he has to.
Until a woman changes his mind. Can't I change yours? Hold me. The way you did when you carried me to this place. Hold me close. This time, instead of touching my lips with water from the stream, kiss me, my darling. Kiss me.
Sharon, I am not for you. I am not for any woman. I'm like any man who sinned, even more so. I'm an outcast. I have no right to...
You have every right to... this. Oh, there. There now. Tell me you don't love me after that.
I do. But there can't be anything between us. Or between me and anyone you don't understand.
Try me. Tell me. Who are you? What are you running from?
I never thought to speak about it again, but here with you, I begin to wonder if maybe I could be forgiven the crime that stained my whole life. You see, there were the two of us. Me, the firstborn. Dark, lonely man. Words come hard, too. And my brother Abe. The opposite. Golden hair. Eyes blue. He was everyone's favorite. My mother Eve, my father Adam. Our name was Manning. We had a farm. I worked in the fields and with the horses, but Abe, he was the shepherd, because we had the biggest flock of merinos in Kentucky. My father's pride and joy. Abe and the sheep. Everything come easy to Abe and hard to me, except in one thing. There was a girl named Sarah, and she and me, we loved each other so much I lost my head, and I took advantage of her once. And things were never the same again. She turned from me to Abe. And that way, everything that lay between us buried come to light.
Hey, Ivan, brother. What brings you my way?
I got some things to talk over with you, little brother.
So, join me in some coffee. It's good and black and strong.
And smells of sheep.
Is that so bad?
My loving brother, whose answer always turns away wrath.
Come on, what are you so hot about? What reason to jump on me now?
What reason all my life? The fair-haired boy who can do no wrong... The chosen?
What do you mean, the chosen?
It's been obvious enough all our lives. I got to break my back in the fields while you have it easy herding these dumb animals. Not that I'd want your job.
Well, then why complain?
Have I ever before?
I don't know. I always thought we got along pretty well.
Why wouldn't you, since you always had the best mama's boy?
Hey, now, wait
a minute. And the apple of our father's eye. You sniveling little toady, you don't care for church or Bible spewing any more than I do, but you have to go pretend every Sunday just to keep in Mom and Pop's good graces.
Well, I don't have to answer you how I feel about God. As for keeping in Mom and Pop's good graces, even if I didn't feel my own pool to religion, I'd never try to hurt their feelings. It's little enough return for all they've done for us.
You know what's really got stuck in my craw and brought me here today? Sarah.
Oh, why? She's spoken to you?
Yes. And I won't have it. I'm the elder. Ever since you were born, you always got the best of it. But taking my woman, I won't stand for.
Well, Sarah's own free choice, not my doing.
It had to be your doing. And when I tell you the real truth, you won't want no soiled goods. She was mine before she ever turned her eyes on you.
Now, that's a lie. You take that back, or it don't make no mind who you are. You better reach for your gun.
I don't take nothing back but what should belong to me. So reach.
stood there, the gun still smoking in my hand. And I looked down on my fair-skinned brother whom I had slain. There was a black fog in my mind. I was more than half mad. I was blind and deaf to a world I wanted to turn off. And suddenly, that great and terrible voice first sounded in my ear.
What hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth to me from the ground. And now art thou cursed from the earth, and I shall set a mark upon thee, lest anyone finding you should kill you.
I left my home, covering my tracks, took only the name Kentuck to myself, and have wanted ever since, every man's hand against me, waiting and praying for death. Only that's the one thing the Lord will let no man bring me.
Poor Kentuck. No wonder you hide from everyone. But you can't hide from me.
I gotta. It's time for me to move on again.
Then I'll go with you.
Now, don't tempt me.
You won't get the chance.
Enoch, what are you doing here?
I saw you follow him, so I followed you.
Now, you stay out of this.
Oh, no. This is showdown time.
Oh, what do you mean? You can't treat me like some kind of possession. Where I go, what I do is my own business, my own decision.
It isn't only you. There are other people to protect against this man.
What other people?
My father. I don't want him shot in the back like the others.
Now, boy, you listen to me and listen good. I shoot no man in the back. I don't have to. Face to face, no man can kill me, so don't get any ideas.
I already got him. I'm calling you out, and I warn you, I'm nearly 20 years younger than you and faster on the draw. This time, you met more than your match.
Don't try to test it.
Cop! Don't you do it! Enos, keep your hands
off your gun.
Tuck. Sarah.
You still recognize me after all these years.
You still recognize me?
If I didn't know you any other way, I would know you for the mark you carry, the mark of shame.
Yes. 20 years I've carried it. Is there no way I can wipe it out?
You could repent and ask God to stretch his hand out to you in mercy.
Well, why should I? Since he was the one who wrote his vengeance on me.
You were born a killer. You want to live as one?
I was born like everyone else. I was made a killer. And since I am doomed to kill anyone but myself, I ride a hard, lonely road. I ask nothing from anyone, and I give nothing in return.
Forget him, Mother. There's no saving him, only the rest of us.
You can't save us, Enoch.
Why not? He's old and tired and ready to be taken, and he deserves to die. I'm calling you out again, old man. Your time has come.
No, Enoch, you are no match for him. Doc, I beg you, don't do this thing in God's name.
In God's name, I have no choice. Okay, boy, let's have done with it. I've traveled a lonely route long enough. Sharon offers me sanctuary and home at last. I'm ready to fight for it, even if you have to die.
Your own son!
Go for your gun.
What did you say?
You took me against my will. The son I bore was not by my present husband or by Abe, who never even knew me. Enoch is your own flesh and blood.
Don't draw, son. Wait. No.
Too late. If I can't have Sharon, damn you, you never will. For her sake, we're all better off dead. Draw.
No. God, please, no. Not kill my son. Have I not suffered enough? Have you no mercy? I couldn't draw against my own son, so, my dear Lord, let me come home to rest at last.
Son, and become my daughter and live in happiness. You never drew your gun.
Thank you for drawing yours. My son, for now the end of a long road that had no ending. It's here. I can go to my real home. At last.
I killed him. I killed my own father.
No, Enoch. You brought him the chance to reach for God, to live hereafter.
I never knew him. I always thought he meant nothing to me, except I never killed a man before.
And I hope never will again. But you couldn't have killed a man who would thank you for it more. Look at him. Look at his hair.
What?
Black. All black, as it was before, when he was young. The white feather. The mark of his crime against God is gone. At last, we can all find peace.
The Lord our God may be a God of vengeance, but he is also merciful. I quote Ecclesiastes 12, verse 1. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, when the evil days come not, or ever the silver cord be loosed, or the golden bowl be broken. Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return to God who gave it. I shall be back shortly. The story you have heard will not have been exactly new to you. We have retold it in its present form because it is as basic and real and true as humanity itself. The story of Cain and Abel is from chapter 4 of Genesis. We have, with reverence and some license, brought you a modern version because we truly believe that 4,000 years have not changed one iota basic conflicts and human relationships. The Bible, its story, and its teachings are as alive today as they were 2,000 years ago. Our cast included Ralph Bell, Marion Seldes, Ian Martin, and Bob Caliban. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Chief flirts with death. Why?
That night, and every night, I went to the gilded cage. And I sat there, breathless, in a state, how else can I say it? Delicious terror, as the lethal knives flew through the air and came to rest against, but not in her body, forming a deadly halo around her head, a lethal collar around her neck. Finally, one evening, scarcely knowing what I was doing, I found myself backstage at Monsieur Delacroix's dressing room door. I got there, I could never tell you. I'm basically a very shy person, but there I was. And before I knew it, I had knocked on the door and it opened.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Contact, the 12-hour cold capsule.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.